A big primary contest is playing out in Georgia this week. If the polls are right, Georgia Republicans are about to deal former President Donald Trump his biggest political defeat this year, with Governor Brian Kemp on his way to a landslide primary victory over David Perdue, despite 18 months of Trump attacking him for not helping him steal the 2020 election. In addition to that, Georgia Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger, who resisted Trump's pressure to find 11,780 votes to overturn President Biden's victory in 2020, is also up for re-election against a big lie proponent, Jody Heiss. In the meantime, in Pennsylvania, known 2020 election denier Doug Mastriano, who attended the January 6th rally, of all things, has already locked in a victory in the Republican primary for governor. Joining me now is attorney and Washington Post contributing columnist George Conway. George, thanks so much for being here. You know, when I read that windup to get to you, it's almost mind-boggling to get my head around what I'm talking about. You know, candidates running for office who, tried to steal an election or wanted to see the election results overturned and so on. But Georgia and Pennsylvania are two big states with a lot of electoral votes. To have these election deniers in the running for these top posts, what's at stake here?
I mean, I think it's very disturbing. I mean, what's great, Georgia is great, but what happened in Pennsylvania was very disturbing, where you have a man who is actually on the Capitol premises on January 6th and who has been promoting election lies ever since. I mean, he didn't go into the Capitol, but he's been promoting these election lies ever since. And he gets to appoint the secretary. If he's elected, he would get to appoint the Secretary of State of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, who is in charge of monitoring and administering elections in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And that's just a very dangerous thing. And if you put that on top of the number of state legislators who have been elected and are continuing to propagate the big lie, there was a great New York Times article about that today. Our democracy is very much endangered by the refusal of people to abide by basically the rule of law and the majority rule.
And just to follow up on that, I mean, do you get the sense that there is great urgency about this? Or are we sort of sleepwalking into this scenario where we might, you know, find ourselves on the other side of these midterms with candidates up and down these ballots in various, very important states around the country who are election deniers, who might conspire to overturn the results of the next presidential election? And then we're just stuck in this, spaceship back to Earth, too. I mean, is that a scenario that you think very well could happen?
Yeah, I do. And I think it's a problem. I think we are, as a nation, to some extent, sleepwalking through this because we've gotten so used to the perpetually abnormal concept of having people basically challenge the basis for our democracy, which is fair elections and majority rule. It's just a remarkable thing that we even are talking about people who still are seeking to challenge the 2020 election and who these people could possibly be elected. But here we are.
And this week, I have to ask you about this because you're no stranger to CPAC conventions. We know that they've happened here in Washington for so many years. We've covered them. We've talked about them. But there's one this week, not in Washington, but in Hungary, where the featured speaker was the country's anti-immigrant authoritarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban. He told the crowd there that the path to power was to have their own media. And he had plenty of praise for Fox's Tucker Carlson. Let's watch.
Of course, the Grand Old Party has associates in the media, associated media, but they do not compete with the dominance of the liberal press. Only my friend Tucker Carlson places himself on the line without wavering. His new program is the most watched. What does it mean? It means that programs like his should run day and night, as you say, 24/7.
And I mean, CPAC is now a place for authoritarians to spread their ideas. And by the way, they had a bunch of other wacky, very out of the mainstream speakers as well, people with all sorts of track records of saying despicable things. What is going on with CPAC?
It's going headed toward full fascist. I don't know how to put it any other way. I mean, Hungary was a backsliding democracy, and now it's barely a democracy, if it's a democracy at all, by any group's ratings. They've suppressed they're suppressing the press. They've thrown out an independent judiciary in effect, and it's basically a scary thing. Of all the countries to pick to have this, they're picking Hungary, and that sends a message. It's a move toward authoritarianism. It's a move against democracy. It's a move against just the contempt of the rule of law, and it's just shocking that they're there, and it's shocking that there are speakers there who are anti-Semitic, anti-Roma, who preach all sorts of nasty hatred, and then we have him joining forces. We have Orban there joining forces with Tucker Carlson. I mean, it's just hard to believe that that's where we are, but that's where we are.
Yeah. And I have to ask you about this. You mentioned the judiciary. There's the judiciary in this country. The Washington Post has obtained emails that show Jenny Thomas, the wife of Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, pressing Arizona lawmakers to overturn Biden's win in the 2020 election. She wrote, in part, "Please reflect on the awesome authority granted to you by our Constitution, and then please take action to ensure that a clean slate of electors is chosen for our state. I also wish to request a meeting with you so I can learn more about what you are doing to ensure our state's vote count is audited and our certification is clean." I love the use of the word clean there. It's anything but.
Yeah, and it's just very disturbing that someone in her position will be sending these emails. Although in this particular circumstance, it's probably not as bad as the text messages to Mark Meadow, because these were form emails of a sort on a website that's designed to send out form emails. But still, I mean, the notion that you can have somebody that close to somebody important in public life advocating overthrowing an election is just scary. And it shows you where the Republican Party has come to. I mean, you know, Jenny was always a little bit out there, and I think the rest of the party has gone, you know, basically over to her side, and that's a disturbing thing, and that's why we see what's happening with CPAC in Hungary, and that's why we see all these election deniers in the House, in the various state houses throughout the country, and why we, you know, why would we have an ongoing battle for basically for our democracy.
And George, I have to ask you about, you know, this thing you posted on Twitter earlier today. You flagged this social media post by Trump on his so-called Truth platform, which is, you know, very Orwellian. But what Trump was, I guess, re-truthing, I suppose, is what they call it, appears to suggest some sort of call for civil war in this country. You know, this is somebody that, I guess, Elon Musk wants back on Twitter. It's just sort of astounding to me. But why are so many Republicans just looking the other way when Trump engages in this kind of incendiary rhetoric?
I think they're just terrified of him. Many of these people know better, and they're terrified of him, but they're also terrified of a Republican base that's become increasingly radicalized, that actually does believe that, you know, people who politically disagree with them are a threat to the nation, and therefore, you know, violence could be necessary to fight them off. And that's what we saw in this social media post that Trump retruthed yesterday. It's
I hate even using
scary.
That term.
I mean, the suggestion was that we are approaching. I know. The suggestion is that somehow we are headed towards civil war, or there should be civil war, or something to that effect. And for a president of the United, former president of the United States, and leading contender for the 2024 Republican nomination, to be even talking about that and suggesting that is just absolutely appalling. But it's all of a piece. Everything we've talked about for the last 10 minutes is just of a piece. The CPAC, the election deniers in the states. It's all part of a fabric that is tearing, that is ripping apart in our country. I mean, Trump could basically go away tomorrow and never be heard from or seen again, and these termites are set loose in our country, eating through the foundations of our democracy. And that is something that we have to take more seriously. I don't think Democrats are taking it serious enough, frankly.
Yeah, even though some of his candidates are losing, the party is still afraid of him. These other folks in the party are afraid of him.
They're still afraid of him, and you know, in 2024, he's got a distinct advantage in a multi-candidate field by virtue of the rules and by virtue of the fact that he is, you know, he still will have 33% of the vote all the way down the line. I don't know if anybody's going to be able to get past him.
Well, you're absolutely right about that, and that is something that I bring up with folks all the time when people say, oh, no, there's no way, you know, he can't do it again. You know, there are all these other candidates. There was a very large field of candidates in 2016, and he was able to pull it off. George Conway, thanks so much for your time. We appreciate it. Hope to have you back soon. Thanks so much.